Hi, everybody. Well, it's 2015, and that means it's a brave new year. I hope that all of you had a wonderful holiday and had the chance to spend time with friends and family. This is the first of 2015's educational presentations, and what better way to start off the year than by a nice look at some of what's new and what's coming in cardiology. Today, the two main topics that we're going to be discussing are cardiac arrest and the changing role of cardiac biomarkers in the evaluation of patients who present to the emergency department with chest pain. Specifically regarding cardiac arrest, we're going to discuss the changing role of epinephrine and therapeutic hypothermia in the management of patients who present with cardiac arrest. We're also going to discuss the impact of perishock pauses during CPR, as well as discuss which patients need to go to cath immediately in the peri-arrest period. Since it's a new year, I have to go ahead and do my annual disclosure statement too, so let me go ahead and just tell you that I have no financial conflicts of interest that I need to disclose. I do, however, have a few confessions. I am, as many of you know, a cat person. I am also a dedicated fan of any and all things Star Wars. And I am also one of those slightly insane people that likes to run for really long distances. Well, now that we've gotten the confessions out of the way, let's get into some cardiology. We'll be talking about several guidelines today, and so before we jump right in, let's take just a moment and review some of the levels of evidence that go into creating these guidelines. The strongest recommendation that a guideline can give is a Class 1 recommendation, in which data shows that there is a clear benefit that outweighs the risks of intervention or treatment. The type of language you may see in those guidelines are things like, "You should do something," or "It is recommended," or "It is indicated that X." In order to achieve a Class 1 level recommendation, you really need to have Level A evidence, which includes meta-analyses or multiple randomized controlled trials that all show a consistent benefit. The next level of recommendation you see in a guideline is a Class 2A recommendation, in which we think that there is probably a benefit, but the data isn't quite as robust as you would get in a Level 1 recommendation. There may be some conflicting data from randomized controlled trials or meta-analyses, or you may just not have data that's as good. You may only have a single randomized controlled trial or non-randomized data. The type of statements you would see in this level of guideline are things like, "It is reasonable to X," or "It may be beneficial." The next level of recommendation is a Class 2B recommendation, in which case we think that there is a possible benefit, but the data is unclear, conflicting, and oftentimes of very poor quality, consisting of things like case reports or expert consensus. The type of statements you might see in these guidelines are, "X may be considered," or "may be reasonable." The last category of recommendation are the Class 3 recommendations, which indicate that a given treatment is either of without benefit or may be harmful. Statements that you may see in these guidelines include things like "not helpful" or "no proven benefit." For a little fun today, every so often we'll look at an ad for a drug that someone really ought to make. On that note, let's go ahead and start our discussion on topics involving cardiac arrest. Cardiac arrest is obviously one of those BFD sort of topics in cardiology. The reason for this is that out-of-hospital cardiac arrest is the third leading cause of death in North America, affecting over 350,000 per year in the U.S. alone. The mortality rate of out-of-hospital cardiac arrest is pretty dismal, approaching 95%. And of those who survive, neurologic recovery is often limited to poor. In recent years, there have been a lot of changes to the approach to cardiac arrest, including an increased emphasis on the quality of CPR and a significant decrease on emphasis on things like drugs. In fact, things like atropine and calcium have been removed from some of the ACLS guidelines because when they were studied, they were shown to have no real benefit in this population. Now the question has arisen about whether epinephrine does anything for patients in cardiac arrest, so let's take a look at some of that literature. Epinephrine for cardiac arrest is certainly not a new treatment. It was described as early as 1941 when the use of intracardiac epinephrine injections were used during cardiac arrest because they were thought to improve the heart muscle tone and stimulate contraction of the myocardium. In 1964, epi was touted as the best resuscitation drug to stimulate myocardial contractions. What's really interesting about this whole topic is that, honestly, nobody really knows the exact mechanism by which epinephrine works in cardiac arrest. As recently as 1990, papers were published because they thought that it increased coronary perfusion pressure. But recently, this has come into question. There is some thought that the beta-adrenergic effects may stimulate myocardial contractility and improve cardiac output, but there are also alpha-adrenergic effects in the periphery that increase peripheral vasoconstriction and increase afterload on the heart. And this might actually be detrimental to systemic perfusion and cardiac output and coronary perfusion. So it's unclear exactly how epi affects patients in cardiac arrest. Instead of taking you through paper after paper regarding epi in cardiac arrest, let's go ahead and just jump right to the meta-analysis that was done on this in 2014. This is a meta-analysis of 14 randomized controlled trials, including over 12,000 patients that suffered out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. They looked at a couple of different scenarios, including standard dose epi versus placebo, standard dose epi versus high dose epi, standard dose epi versus vasopressin, as well as standard dose epi versus vasopressin plus epi. The primary outcome was survival to hospital discharge, whereas secondary outcomes looked at return of spontaneous circulation, survival to hospital admission, and neurological outcomes. When they looked at standard dose epi versus placebo, they found that epi had a very small benefit for the return of spontaneous circulation, as well as survival to hospital admission. However, that did not translate into survival at discharge, nor improved neurologic outcomes. As you can see, the confidence intervals for both of these two outcomes crossed one, so unfortunately there was no difference. Effectively, the only thing epi actually accomplished was to change the location of death from the field or the ED to the ICU. When they looked at standard dose epi versus high dose epi, they found that there was actually harm associated with high dose epi on return of spontaneous circulation and survival to admission. But again, there was no difference in survival to discharge or neurologic outcome. There was one trial in this meta-analysis that looked at standard dose epi versus vasopressin, and they found that there was no difference in the return of spontaneous circulation. This trial didn't assess survival to admission to the hospital, but they did assess survival to discharge and neurologic outcome, and again found that there was no difference in either of these outcomes. Lastly, these authors also looked at standard dose epi versus the combination of vasopressin plus epi. And again, they found no difference in any of the patient-centered outcomes, such as survival to discharge or neurological outcome. In fact, they also found that there was no difference in return of spontaneous circulation or survival to admission either. So the bottom line for epinephrine in cardiac arrest is that there is no proven benefit to epinephrine. The most recent update of the AHA-ACLS guidelines in 2010 acknowledged the lack of evidence to support the use of epi, and the recommendation is appropriately worded so that it's not actually wrong to decide not to use epinephrine during your arrests. They specifically say that, quote, it is reasonable to consider administering a 1 milligram dose of epi, and again, they list this as a Class 2B recommendation. While it seems that epinephrine use might increase the rate of return of spontaneous circulation, it doesn't improve any meaningful patient-centered outcomes, such as survival to hospital discharge or improved neurologic recovery. And it seems that using epinephrine basically just changes the destination of death to the ICU instead of the ED or pre-hospital setting. It's worth considering the economic impact of this on families as well. It'll be interesting to see what the new guidelines coming out in the next couple of years will say based on the new data and the new meta-analysis, as there have been a number of new trials looking at this, and so far, none of them have shown a benefit to the use of epi. When more just isn't enough. Okay, let's move on and talk about another hot topic in cardiac arrest patients, which is the use of therapeutic hypothermia post-arrest. Therapeutic hypothermia really gained wide acceptance as a treatment for post-cardiac arrest patients in 2002. This was primarily studied in patients with either VFib or VTAC arrests. Theoretically, it was thought that this would prevent or reduce hypoxic brain injury by decreasing the brain's oxygen demand and reducing the production of excitatory neurotransmitters that may increase apoptosis. It was also thought that it may reduce the production of free radicals that cause reperfusion injury. In fact, when the 2013 Guidelines for Management of ST Elevation MI were published, therapeutic hypothermia was given a Class 1 recommendation, despite the fact that the level of evidence really doesn't quite support that level of a recommendation. This is the first of the two articles published in the New England Journal that really put therapeutic hypothermia on the map. It's a randomized controlled trial looking at 275 patients after VFib or VTAC arrest. 137 were randomized to hypothermia, whereas 138 were randomized to normothermia. In the hypothermia group, their temperatures were managed to 32 to 34 degrees centigrade very tightly for 24 hours. However, in the normothermia group, their temperatures were basically just left alone. On follow-up, survival with good neurological outcome was substantially higher in the group that was treated with therapeutic hypothermia versus the normothermia group. When we look at a chart of the patient's temperatures over time during the course of the study, it's interesting to notice that a lot of the non-cooled patients actually became hyperthermic during the course of the trial. The hypothermia group received very tight temperature control. However, the normothermia group pretty much was just left alone. When we looked at the second major trial on therapeutic hypothermia that the New England Journal published in 2002, it's pretty much the same story. This is a smaller trial including 77 patients with a witnessed VFib or VTAC arrest, and 43 were randomized to hypothermia, and again received tight temperature control to 33 degrees for 12 hours. However, the 34 patients that were randomized to normothermia had a temperature maintained at or above 37 degrees, with no real prevention of hyperthermia. And again, this paper found that there was a survival benefit to therapeutic hypothermia. Now, I wouldn't be being a very good EBM guru if I didn't find at least a few problems with these trials. So, they were published in 2002, and the data in them were gathered between 1997 and 2001. Because of this, a whole lot more patients in these trials got lytics than would currently receive them today in the era of primary PCI. The majority of these data also include only VFib and VTach arrests and don't include PEA or asystolic arrests. It's unclear exactly how the time to implementation affects outcomes in these trials, and there was also no focus on the maintenance of euthermia in the non-cooled group. Unfortunately, these trials left us with a lot of questions about what the ideal temperature for hypothermia actually was, and so this trial was completed in 2013 to try and answer that question. This trial was a randomized controlled trial of 950 patients that had an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. 476 of these patients were randomized to tight temperature control at 32 to 33 degrees, whereas the other 474 were randomized to a 35 to 36 degree group, where again the temperature was maintained very tightly for 28 hours. 937 patients were included in the final analysis, and 80% of them had VF or VT arrests, whereas 20% of them had either asystole or PEA arrest. I personally like the fact that they included these because so many of these studies have been making generalizations about the treatment of patients with this type of arrest when the only patients that were studied had either VF or VT. The primary outcome in this trial were the number of patients that had died at the end of the trial. Secondary outcomes included assessment of neurologic function at the time of follow-up and the number of patients that had died at the end of 180 days. These data showed that there was no difference between any of the groups, either in the primary outcome or in any of the secondary outcomes. In fact, in this trial, therapeutic hypothermia actually did not have an impact on neurologic recovery. When these patients' temperatures were charted over time for the 28 hours of the trial, we can see that the temperatures were actually very tightly maintained in both groups. Passive rewarming was then allowed beyond 28 hours, and substantially less hyperthermia occurred in the normothermia group than in prior trials. One of the other major questions that was left unanswered by a lot of the other trials was the timing of initiation of therapeutic hypothermia. This paper that was published in JAMA earlier in 2014 sought to answer that question. They performed a randomized controlled trial of 1,359 patients, 583 of whom had a VFib arrest, whereas the rest had a non-VFib arrest such as asystole or PEA. They randomized these patients to be cooled either in the pre-hospital setting versus after arrival in the hospital. The study evaluated the mortality and their neurologic status at hospital discharge in both of the groups. The patients that had pre-hospital initiation of cooling were cooled more rapidly and achieved a core temperature that on average was about 1.2 degrees centigrade cooler on arrival to the ED, and also took about 1 hour less on average to achieve a core temperature of 34 degrees. Unfortunately, they found that it didn't really seem to make a difference when the patients were cooled, either in the pre-hospital or emergency department settings. Even when they separated the patients out into the group that had VFib arrest versus the group with a non-VFib arrest, even then it did not achieve statistical significance between the groups, and they were unable to find a benefit with rapid cooling. So the bottom line for therapeutic hypothermia is that it doesn't quite seem to be the magical intervention we were all hoping it would be. In fact, it seems that the prevention of hyperthermia is probably more important than achieving hypothermia itself. Based on the trial that was published in the New England Journal last year, it appears that 35 to 36 degrees is just as efficacious as 32 to 33, as long as the patient doesn't become hyperthermic. It also seems that pre-hospital cooling really doesn't improve outcomes, but this also assumes an urban setting with short transport times, and this may not be applicable to places that have very long transport times out in rural areas. So it is possible that in these areas, earlier initiation of targeted temperature management may be beneficial. Let's move on to the next topic, which is the effect of a peri-shock pause in CPR during cardiac arrest. In the last few years, there have been multiple trials that all demonstrate that probably more than anything else we do during a cardiac resuscitation, that the quality of CPR matters. In fact, it's probably the single most important factor in survival and neurologic outcome in these patients. There are a number of different factors that all impact the quality of the CPR, including the length and number of perishock pauses, the depth and the rate of chest compressions, as well as the chest wall recoil of the patient. There have been numerous commercial devices that have been developed to address issues of chest compression, depth, and rate, and these are also things that we can address in training as well. However, perishock pause are one of the few things that we as physicians can control during resuscitation. This paper was published last year in the journal Resuscitation and is a reanalysis of data from the prior PRIMED trial. The authors were looking at this previously collected data to reanalyze it and see if they could find an association between the length of a perishock pause and survival to hospital discharge. They included 2,006 patients, all of whom had a witnessed out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. They included patients that presented with a shockable rhythm, and all of them had CPR process data for at least one shock. The authors found that there was no difference in the quality of compressions between the two groups. Their primary outcome was to evaluate survival to discharge, while their secondary outcome was to look at the neurologic status of the patients that did survive to hospital discharge. When we look at the duration of the CPR pause, it's pretty clear from this chart that there was a pretty abrupt drop-off in the rates of survival with a pre-shock pause that was greater than 15 seconds long. When the authors looked at what was causing the pauses to be so long, most of the time it was people that were removing their hands from the chest while waiting for defibrillators to charge and on rhythm checks after the shock was delivered. The results for the perishock pause were essentially identical to the pattern we saw with the pre-shock pause, with a drop-off in survival occurring right around 20 seconds. The findings for neurologic recovery parallel these findings as well, with a perishock pause duration of less than 20 seconds being the tipping point, where the prognosis for neurologic outcome seems to drop off significantly. Ultimately, what these authors found is that the best odds of survival occurred when the pre-shock pause was less than 15 seconds long. However, the best neurologic recovery occurred with a pre-shock pause of less than 10 seconds. When the authors looked at the odds of survival modeled with time as a continuous variable, they found that every 5-second increase in the pre-shock pause decreased the odds of survival by 7%, and essentially the same thing occurred for the perishock pause, with the odds of survival dropping by 6% for every 5 seconds paused. Interestingly, there really wasn't a significant relationship with the post-shock pause, possibly due to the fact that a number of patients had return of spontaneous circulation after the shock. So it seems like the pre-shock pause is where the biggest bang for your buck occurs. So the bottom line for this paper is that the perishock pause time during CPR really does matter. Try to minimize the time the patient spends without having ongoing compressions. Things you can do to help with this are to continue compressions while the defibrillator is charging. And just reassure the person doing compressions that you're not going to shock them and that you're going to give them an opportunity to lift their hands off the chest, let you shock, and then immediately put the hands back on the chest and resume compressions. Your perishock pause can be as little as 2 to 3 seconds with this method. There's been some interesting work done on hands-on defibrillation recently as well that suggests that this is probably safe to do, and if you're comfortable doing that, it's another option, but that's a topic for a whole nother discussion. Practice your ultrasound skills and have the machine on and ready to go so that you can keep your ultrasound checks to less than 10 seconds. Try to minimize the frequency of your rhythm checks as well. A good time to sneak those in is when the CPR providers are swapping out. All right, last topic on cardiac arrest. Let's talk about post-arrest PCI and which patients should be getting this. The most recent update of the guidelines from 2013 regarding the management of ST elevation MI gave a Class 1 recommendation to immediate angiography and PCI in patients that were resuscitated from out-of-hospital cardiac arrests whose initial EKG shows a STEMI, and I don't think any of us would disagree with this. So, what do you do about patients whose initial EKG doesn't show a STEMI? So here's a paper that was published within the last year that was a retrospective observational trial including 754 consecutive comatose patients status post cardiac arrest that were all enrolled prospectively. What I really like about this study is that they excluded all the STEMI patients because we already knew that those patients were going to go to the cath lab. All of these patients were comatose, and so they also all received therapeutic hypothermia. Out of all the patients enrolled, there were about 36% that had a VFib or VTAC arrest. Of these, 122 went to the cath lab early, versus the other 147 who either never went to the cath lab at all or went to the cath lab 24 hours or later after their initial presentation. So overall, out of that 269 patients, over a quarter of them had an acute coronary occlusion that required PCI. So let's break this down a little bit further. Out of that 122 patients who went to the cath lab early, 32% of those patients were found to have a coronary lesion that was amenable to stenting. Out of the 147 that did not go to cath early, there were 106 that never went to the cath lab at all, and 41 went to the cath lab in delayed fashion. Out of those who went in delayed fashion, 16 out of that 41 had a coronary lesion that required a stent placement. So if we look at all of the patients that didn't have a STEMI on their EKG that went to the lab, almost 35% of those had a lesion that was amenable to stenting. My immediate response to this data is, that's cool. But what I really want to know is how this actually impacted the patients, and whether or not it had any impact on any of the patient-centered outcomes that we really give a crap about, like how many patients survived a hospital discharge, and what was their neurologic recovery like. Fortunately, these authors knew exactly what we were going to say, and so they looked at all of these groups in terms of their survival and neurologic recovery after arrest, based on whether they got cath early, late, or whether they never went at all. And as you can see, there was a pretty pronounced difference between the groups depending on whether or not and when you went to the cath lab. Here's another trial that was published within the last year. And this one is a retrospective reanalysis of data from a prior randomized controlled trial evaluating the effect of CPR. What they were looking at in the original trial was the effect of functional recovery and on survival to discharge after CPR was performed for a brief interval or for a full 3 minutes prior to rhythm analysis and defibrillation for VFib. They didn't find any differences between the groups in the original trial, and so the authors looked at the same dataset and analyzed rates of survival and neurologic outcome depending on whether the patients went to cath early versus late. In the original trial, they looked at almost 17,000 adults who had an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. This trial looked at just shy of 4,000 of those because they only included patients that survived for greater than 60 minutes in the hospital, so that they could look at only the patients who actually survived to cardiac cath. Out of those, 765 went to the cath lab early, but there were also some patients that got reperfused with thrombolytics in this trial, and so the total number of patients that were reperfused either via PCI or with thrombolysis was 705. Also, out of all the patients that survived for greater than 60 minutes, approximately half of them received therapeutic hypothermia. In this trial, about 75% of the patients that had a STEMI on their original EKG went to the cath lab or got reperfused early, whereas only about 15% of the patients that didn't have a STEMI got early reperfusion. However, despite that, they still found a survival benefit in both groups with early reperfusion. Of note, about 18% of the reperfused patients got lytics instead of cath, as some of the centers participating in the original trial didn't have immediate access to cardiac cath, and the patients had to be transferred to go to the cath lab. They also looked at the patients who got hypothermia versus those who did not, and they also showed that regardless of whether you went to the cath lab or not, therapeutic hypothermia did have a survival benefit, which is further evidence suggesting that targeted temperature management is important. I think the real take-home from this particular trial, however, is that those patients who were reperfused early and had therapeutic hypothermia did far better than the patients who had one or neither of these interventions. So what's the bottom line regarding PCI after cardiac arrest? Well, based on these two papers and some of the other evidence out there, I would suggest that patients should probably go to the cath lab after cardiac arrest, even if a STEMI is absent on their initial EKG, because it seems to improve survival and neurologic outcome. I think that these papers are pretty powerful, and it's fairly clear that with the exception of patients that you're pretty sure arrested for some obvious non-cardiac reason like trauma, or an obvious intracranial catastrophe, or the Mount Vesuvius sort of GI bleeding, that we need to be sending our post-arrest patients to cath. The problem with this is that unfortunately, there are a number of cardiologists that aren't up to date on this literature, and so we may have to push them to be a little more aggressive about this. Because the data shows that up to 30% of patients without a STEMI on their original post-arrest EKG will have a lesion that's amenable to stenting and actually do better if they go to the cath lab early. Now that we are all completely tired of talking about cardiac arrest, let's switch gears and talk about a different topic that's kind of hot in cardiology right now, and that's biomarkers. So first of all, let's talk about the role of CKMB. Or what I really hope to convince you of is the non-role of CKMB in the evaluation of patients who present to the ED with acute chest pain. The search for that perfect biomarker is something that we've been pursuing for a long time. Prior to 1980, we were looking at things like total CK, LDH, AST, and a few other things as the primary biomarkers that were assayed several times a day, often for several days, trying to figure out whether or not there was any myocardial ischemia. The problem with this approach is that all of these enzymes are found in other tissues, which makes the diagnosis difficult and lengthy. Post-1980, up through about 1997, CKMB became the benchmark biomarker for acute MI. However, in 1997, troponin was introduced and kind of became the new baby of cardiology because the troponins showed better sensitivity and specificity for myocardial injury than CKMB. As you would expect, over the last 15 years, troponin assays have gradually been improving and getting more and more sensitive. What's really become the new shiny thing in the last year or two is that as of 2013, some new super high sensitivity troponin assays have been introduced into the fray. In my medical training, I was taught the dogma of the biomarkers, and what I was taught was that myoglobin and CK rise earlier than troponins, and so these are better early markers of myocardial ischemia and injury. The reason I say that that's dogma is that that was based on the original troponin assay that was introduced way back in 1997, and that probably hasn't been accurate for almost 10 years. I think most of us are painfully familiar with this graphic that was published in the Journal of the American College of Cardiology in January of 2006. This shows that myoglobin and CKMB peak earlier than troponin, and that it could take up to 8 hours for troponin to cross the threshold to where it was actually a positive test. However, this was based on those original troponin assays, and the newer generation troponin assays are reliably positive much earlier, and the newest high-sensitivity troponin assays are detectable within 1 to 2 hours of symptom onset, which is actually earlier than myoglobin or CK. Now, I know there's a lot of folks out there that still love them some CK-MB, but I'm not the only person to say that there's really no role for it in the current evaluation of chest pain. The National Academy of Clinical Biochemistry Practice Guidelines that came out in 2007 gave a Class 1 clear benefit to using cardiac troponin as the preferred biomarker for the diagnosis of acute MI. And in fact, they went on to say that CKMB is an acceptable alternative only to be used when cardiac troponin is not available. One of the other things they did in these guidelines that was actually kind of a nice thing is they gave you an out. If you don't think the patient has ACS, you don't have to send a troponin, even if the patient is presenting with the chief complaint of chest pain. Here's another document on the topic. This is the third universal definition of myocardial infarction that was developed in conjunction with the European Society of Cardiology, the American College of Cardiology Foundation, the American Heart Association, and the World Heart Federation. What this document does is update the current definition of acute MI based on our most current understanding of the disease. All of these societies have come together to state the position that troponin is the preferred biomarker, and again, that CKMB should only be utilized if and when troponin is not available. So if there's anyone out there that's still just not buying it, here's the grand poobah of all the recommendations. This is literally less than a couple months old and was published at the end of 2014, published online, and still isn't actually available in print yet. The 2014 guidelines from the AHA and the American College of Cardiology gave a Class 1 benefit to using cardiac-specific troponin measured at presentation and 3 to 6 hours after symptom onset in patients in which ACS is suspected. And even though we all know that the evidence has shown this for years, they finally came out and said it. Class 3, no benefit. With contemporary troponin assays, CKMB and myoglobin are not useful for the diagnosis of ACS, with a level of evidence A. So it's pretty clear to me that CKMB is a dinosaur looking for a tar pit, and it's time for us to stop using it in the ED. One of the other things that I really like about this recommendation is that it also gets rid of that 6 to 8 or 12 hour time window we have to wait before we send a repeat troponin. This guideline says that 3 to 6 hours is our time window, which is going to shorten ED stays by a big chunk if we're looking at a 3 hour troponin as opposed to a 6 to 8 hour troponin. So for all of the whiners who don't want to give up their CKMB test, despite the fact that the guidelines say not to use it anymore, here's a paper with a hilariously overdramatic title that discusses some other things to consider before you just check the box. Problems with CKMB testing are pretty numerous. Number one, cost. In the last year, at our hospitals, we saw about 13,000 patients with the complaint of chest pain in the ED. And this doesn't even count all the weak and dizzy, short of breath, altered mental status, and yada 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 patients that we send enzymes on. At the cost of about $11 per assay, CKMB would cost the hospital about $143,000 for chest pain patients alone. Considering that there are nearly 6 million ED visits for chest pain annually, suddenly that's $66 million on a useless test. And you'd better believe that the insurance companies are going to be getting savvy to this pretty quick now that these new guidelines are out. And it wouldn't surprise me one bit if we stopped getting reimbursed for this test. It's also become clear that in recent years, the commitment to the quality assurance of CKMB has waned significantly, and so there's considerable machine-to-machine variability, and we shouldn't expect to see any improvements in the quality of this assay over time. We're also not using it correctly, because recent data have shown that if we're actually going to use CKMB, we should actually be using gender-specific reference ranges and cutoffs, and that's not something that we typically see reported on our lab printouts. And lastly, CKMB is less specific than modern troponins and less sensitive. Unfortunately, by being less specific, we're actually going to be increasing the amount of testing that patients get downstream if we use this test. And unfortunately, the more unnecessary testing we do, it becomes more and more likely that we'll actually be more likely to harm patients than help them. So what's the bottom line in regards to the use of CKMB in the ED? Well, as of the release of the new guidelines at the end of 2014, troponins are the biomarkers of choice, and we should be using these exclusively in the evaluation of our chest pain patients. So unfortunately, CKMB and myoglobin, you are dead to us, and you no longer have any role in the evaluation of acute chest pain in the ED. All right, guys, we've made it to the home stretch. The last thing we're going to talk about today, now that we've finished trashing CKMB, are the troponins and how we're going to be using them in the future. A question that comes up all the time in the ED is, how many troponins do I need to get on this patient? And is one troponin ever enough? The simple answer to that is that yes, there are some circumstances in which one troponin is more than adequate. In 2006, which it's hard to believe, but that's almost 10 years ago now, ACEP put out a position statement that a single troponin was adequate to rule out MI if it was obtained at least 8 hours after the onset of symptoms. There's actually been precedent in the literature for a single troponin rule-out for over 10 years, as long as it was greater than 8 hours after the onset of symptoms. However, this really hasn't been put into practice despite these statements and guidelines stating that this is acceptable practice. The other thing to consider is that this guideline is based on standard troponins that were available in the early 2000s, and the current generation of troponins is much more sensitive than this. Current guidelines, including the 2014 guidelines we reviewed just a few slides ago, suggest that a troponin within 3 to 6 hours of pain onset may be adequate. As these tests become more and more sensitive, we can expect that these times will continue to decrease. Let's look at a few of the new papers that have come out in the last year and talk about some strategies on how we use troponins. This paper is the ADAPT trial that came out in 2012, and was a prospective observational study of almost 2,000 patients that showed up in the ED with possible acute coronary syndrome. They excluded STEMI patients from this trial, and I think that that's a really good idea because it's kind of a no-brainer what we do about STEMI patients. It's the ones that don't have something that clear-cut that are challenging. In this study, all of the patients that were enrolled were screened with an accelerated diagnostic pathway, and their primary outcome was to follow those patients up and see how many of them had a major adverse cardiac event within 30 days. Their major adverse events included death, cardiac arrest, need for emergency revascularization, cardiogenic shock, ventricular arrhythmia needing an intervention, or acute MI. Patients with a negative ADP were classified as low risk, and that involved having a TIMI score of 0, no ischemic changes on the initial EKG, and a cardiac troponin concentration obtained both at arrival and 2 hours after arrival in the ED that was below the institutional cutoff for a positive troponin. Out of the 1,975 patients in this trial, 302, approximately 15%, had a major adverse cardiac event. The ADP classified 392 patients, about 20% of the total population, as low risk. Only one of those patients that was classified as low risk had a major adverse cardiac event, which basically means that this protocol had a sensitivity of 99.7% and a negative predictive value of 99.7% as well. The downside is, of course, that you had pretty low specificity in order to be that sensitive, with a positive predictive value of only 19%. 316 of the patients that were classified as low risk had further workup within 30 days, none of whom had a major cardiac event, but 18 who did go on to require an intervention. The one patient that was classified as low risk that did have a major adverse cardiac event presented less than 1 hour from the time of symptom onset and had an initial troponin of less than 0.01 and a 2-hour troponin of 0.03. And so he was kept for a third troponin at 6 hours, which at that point was 14. so he was admitted and treated as a non-ST elevation MI and did well. I suspect that he probably fell out due to the fact that he just presented so very early into his course. I'm sure that most of you are already aware that there's a new kid on the block. At the end of 2013, a new high-sensitivity cardiac troponin T assay became available. What we've been using at our hospital is a fourth-generation cardiac troponin T with a sensitivity such that 0.01 nanograms per mil can be detected in the serum. These newer high-sensitivity troponins are a whole order of magnitude more sensitive. Basically, shift the decimal point over to the left by one, and there you go. Due to a lower level of detection and increased precision, the high-sensitivity assays are able to detect much more subtle elevations indicative of cardiac injury. So, the logical question to ask is, how good are they? So, here's a paper that was published in the New England Journal in 2009 when these were still being studied. This is a multicenter prospective trial that compared the performance of the high-sensitivity troponin to the standard assays that were out there, including troponin I, troponin T, CKMB, and myoglobin, all of which were measured at presentation as well as 1, 2, 3, and 6 hours after presentation. What they found was that the high-sensitivity troponins were more sensitive at 2 hours after the onset of pain than any other assay. The combination of the high-sensitivity troponin and the CKMB didn't increase the area under the curve provided by the results of the high-sensitivity troponin alone, and translated into English, that just means the addition of the other tests like CKMB and myoglobin didn't add any useful information over the high-sensitivity troponin alone. Now that the new high-sensitivity troponins are available, the question becomes, have we found the holy grail, and can we finally do this with one troponin? Here's a paper where they asked that question. This is an observational trial of almost 15,000 patients who presented to the emergency department with chest pain or symptoms that were thought to be consistent with possible acute coronary syndrome. They measured a high-sensitivity cardiac troponin T at the time of presentation and found that almost 9,000, or 61%, had a negative, less than 5 nanogram per liter, high-sensitivity troponin. About a fifth of the patients had kind of an indeterminate troponin, whereas about 20% had a positive troponin at greater than 14 nanograms per liter. The primary outcome was a fatal or non-fatal MI within 30 days, whereas secondary outcomes included MI within 180 and 365 days, as well as all-cause mortality within 30, 180, and 365 days. At 30 days, 39, or just under 0.5% of the patients with an initially negative high-sensitivity troponin had an MI. Out of those, 24 had ischemic changes on their initial EKGs, including 15 patients that had a STEMI, and 9 that had ischemic changes, and ultimately, those patients had a non-ST elevation MI. The 15 remaining patients, or 0.17%, had no initial ischemic EKG changes, and this was confirmed by a blinded cardiologist who subsequently reread all of the EKGs and confirmed that none of these patients had any initial ischemic changes. Based on this, the negative predictive value for MI was 99.8% after a single negative troponin, and the negative predictive value for death at 30 days was 100%. At 365 days, there were 38 deaths in patients with an initially negative cardiac troponin. However, only 2 of those were due to cardiac etiology, representing 0.02% of the population of the study. 32 patients died from cancer, and 4 were due to other causes such as trauma, pulmonary disease, and so on. Let's take a look at those 15 patients that had a negative initial troponin and no initial EKG changes. Of those 15, 73%, or 11 of them, presented within 2 hours of symptom onset. 20% had a history of known prior coronary disease. In fact, one of them had had a CABG and 3 prior MIs. 40% were heavy smokers, and 4 out of the 15 developed EKG changes on repeat EKG while they were still in the emergency department. Out of those 15, no deaths occurred. So where does this leave us? Well, I'm not quite sure that a single troponin obtained less than 2 hours from symptom onset is quite ready for prime time. However, I do think that a single troponin obtained, say, 6 hours from the onset of symptoms would be a very reasonable thing to do. And not only that, but a delta troponin obtained 2 hours after the initial, if still negative, is certainly adequate to rule these patients out, as both of these trials showed sensitivity in excess of 99%. Frankly, unless you decide you're going to screen everybody with a chest, we're probably just never going to be able to get any better than that. Before we all just jump right onto the high-sensitivity troponin bandwagon, it's fair to point out that there are certainly upsides and downsides to using these. The high-sensitivity troponins are more sensitive and may allow earlier detection of ischemia in the ED, facilitating more rapid diagnostic ED evaluation through rapid diagnostic protocols. Just like the original troponins, there's no need for other biomarkers associated with them. But we should also take a moment and think about the downsides, too. Because they're more sensitive, they're less specific, so we should expect that we're going to see more false positives, and unfortunately, we may actually start having an increase in workups for people that have non-acute coronary syndrome elevated troponins. Plus, I expect that we'll probably start having an increased detection of type 2 MI, which is defined as myocardial injury or ischemia that occurs due to something other than coronary artery disease. As troponin assays have gotten better over the years, we've learned that there are lots of other medical conditions that can result in myocardial strain and produce some level of detectable troponin. Diagnoses such as pulmonary embolism, myocarditis, pericarditis, sepsis, tachydysrhythmias, heart failure, even things like taser shocks and sustained vigorous exercise like marathoning or ultramarathoning, has produced detectable levels of troponin in the serum of these patients. With the high-sensitivity troponins, we just have to remember that we're not getting something for nothing. What we're gaining in sensitivity, we're giving up in specificity. So the bottom line in regards to troponins is that, number one, single troponin rule-outs are coming. They're currently completely acceptable when symptom onset is greater than 8 hours after the troponin, and probably closer to 6 hours with the newer assays. Repeat troponins 3 or even 2 hours apart are probably quite acceptable, based on the studies that are out there showing really good sensitivity. High-sensitivity troponins may lead to more rapid rule-outs in the future, but keep in mind that troponin alone is not specific to MI anymore, because we've become so sensitive. In the era of the high-sensitivity troponin, it's more important than ever that we're a good clinician and that we don't miss the GI bleed with a hemoglobin of 3 that's causing them to have an elevated troponin, or the PE with strain, just because their troponin wound up being a little positive. There are lots of clinical entities other than MI that will cause a troponin leak, so we need to be aware of that and continue to make sure we're not missing those conditions.